Next up is Eirikir, who is a programmer, musician, and artist, and years ago was one of the maintainers of Ang Band, and also, I believe, was at Roguelike 2016. That's correct. You were kind enough, you came to my talk, even though the developers of Rogue were speaking in the other room. So I've had fond memories ever since, so it's great to have you back.
Thank you.
Talking this time about Uxn and permacomputing, which is very exciting.
All right. Well, thank you. Yeah, so welcome to my lightning talk, Uxn, permacomputing, and roguelikes. During this talk, I'll explain what Uxn is, why I find it interesting as a platform for roguelikes, and how I think its lessons can help roguelike developers. First, just a bit about myself. I've been programming for a little over 20 years, both as a hobby and professionally. I help maintain Angband, as Alexei said, but at this point, I'm more of an emeritus Angband developer. I've worked on games using a variety of languages, such as C, Lua, Python, JavaScript, Twine, Inform, and Uxntal. However, I've never worked in the games industry or sold games professionally to make a living, so caveat emptor. About 3 years ago, I discovered the Uxn ecosystem. Pretty quickly, I started targeting almost all my hobby programming, including my game development energy, toward Uxn. I've implemented a regular expression engine, fixed point arithmetic, and many other programs and libraries. Basically, it captured my imagination. Uxn was created by Devin Lulin Vega and the 100 Rabbits Collective. Their decision to become full-time nomads living aboard a sailboat introduced the constraints that motivated the design of Uxn. As intriguing as that sounds, I'm going to avoid talking about them too much more in this talk because I only have 10 minutes. I could easily spend all of that time summarizing their projects and adventures. I definitely encourage you to look them up after this talk. Uxn describes a small, mostly self-contained computing ecosystem consisting of Uxntal assembly language, Varvara virtual machine specification, emulators for various platforms, and then ROMs implementing programs, games, etc. Sort of like a NES ROMs. To dig in slightly, the Uxntal assembly language is an 8-bit stack-based instruction set with 64 kilobytes of addressable memory. The Varvara virtual machine specification documents how to do I/O, draw to the screen, play sounds, etc. There are Uxn emulators for many platforms, such as SDL X11, the web, Linux Frame Buffer, x86 BIOS, Nintendo handhelds, and a whole bunch more. Really exciting. And just to give you a sense, so ROMs implementing programs and games are pretty small usually. Here are some example file sizes. So as you can see, 450 bytes for a Mandelbrot visualization, 517 for an animated Julia set visualization, 11K for a terminal emulator, 19K for a Klondike solitaire game, and so on. As I said above, the language and virtual machine are intentionally very limited. Here are some additional limitations I haven't mentioned yet. Built-in data types are just 8 and 16-bit integers. The VM is mostly single-threaded. File system access is sandboxed to the working directory only. No built-in networking support and a four-color display, but with configurable colors. These limitations do constrain the types of programs which are a good fit for Uxn, but they can also be freeing. The original Rogue was limited to monochrome ASCII characters on an 80 by 24 character display, so Uxn represents a significant upgrade over the original roguelike. Here are some examples of what Uxn programs can look like. So really quickly, here's that Mandelbrot set program I showed you. So this is four colors, but as you can see, they're kind of dithered here to create the illusion of more rainbow colors. Similarly, with the Julia set, we can sort of see it animating. I've got it running at a particular speed, sort of moving the control point around. Here's the terminal emulator. This is running locally on my machine, so you can kind of get a sense of it. Just to kind of prove that it's really handling all the ANSI control characters correctly, we can have it kind of update 10 times a second here to sort of jump around a little bit. And finally, here's the solitaire game. I'm not going to make you watch me play solitaire or anything, but I just wanted to kind of show you that it really exists. You can really move the cards around, and so on. Back to the talk. Okay. So now you hopefully have at least a vague sense of what Uxn is. I use the term permacomputing in the talk title. Some of you may be wondering what that is or what it has to do with Uxn or roguelikes. The name permacomputing comes from permaculture, a term coined in 1978 to describe sustainable alternatives to industrial agriculture. Like permaculture, there is not a simple definition of permacomputing. Despite this, I will give some directives that I think will give you all a sense of what permacomputing is. So first of all, let's design for older devices and keep older devices useful as long as possible. Let's build for cultural and ecological permanence, not have stuff that's kind of throwaway. Do more with less, and even better, do less with less. conserve energy and materials when deploying new systems and sort of minimize complexity. Hopefully these will give a broad sense of permacomputing, focus on reducing the ecological footprint of software and hardware while kind of maximizing their relative usefulness to us. So let's just consider these in the context of what I've said about Uxn. As I said, Uxn runs on 20-year-old handheld devices and 30-year-old computers, so as well as modern devices, web browsers, et cetera. So it should be possible to use Uxn on almost any system in use today. And as far as permanence, ROM should continue to work on any future platform as long as emulators can be written. The spec is simple enough. We've already seen dozens of implementations, so nothing is certain. But if people want to run Uxn ROMs in the future and they have the spec, they probably can. Doing less. So as I mentioned, there's fewer colors, not very much memory, et cetera. So this kind of encourages us to consider whether we can achieve our goals or maybe a subset of our goals just using that. Conserving energy materials hopefully is pretty self-explanatory as far as, making use of old computers. And finally, minimizing complexity. A simpler VM is easy to distribute, test, re-implement, et cetera. So hopefully you can see the influence of permacomputing on the design of Uxn. But what about roguelikes? What do they have to do with permacomputing? Dennis Ritchie once said that Rogue was the biggest waste of CPU cycles in history. My sense is that Ritchie would probably have considered any video game a waste of CPU cycles, but it's still worth interrogating this. Was Rogue wasteful? I'd argue the Rogue fit our permacomputing directives fairly well. It targeted systems that already existed. New gaming hardware did not need to be created to play Rogue. Permanence, 40 years later, we're still playing and talking about Rogue and its descendants. Do less. Rogue made do without graphics, sound, or any kind of animation. It used procedural generation to minimize assets and increase replayability. It could be played over a phone line in the early 80s. Conserve energy materials, as above, it was just a handful of people working on it to do all this. It really didn't take a lot of work. And minimizing complexity. Rogue was simple enough that it was updated, ported, copied, and remixed into an entire genre. Rogue has been so influential precisely because of its simplicity. I'm not claiming this is the only way to look at video games from a permacomputing angle, just that I think it's an interesting one for us to consider at Roguelike Celebration. So if you don't violently disagree with me about Uxn and permacomputing or roguelikes, I guess my first thesis would be Uxn is a good fit for roguelikes because it's aligned with many of the things that made Rogue and roguelikes interesting and successful. It also happens to be a good fit for the state of software development and the world in 2024. At this point in the talk, I've been hoping to show off my own roguelike demo and walk you through how it worked. Unfortunately, life got in the way and I don't have much to show yet. Instead, I'll just take a minute to walk through how Varvara works. If you're old enough to have programmed for the Apple II, Commodore 64, or similar 8-bit systems, some of this might be familiar. So the virtual machine consists of a program counter, just a 16-bit value. It's the address of the next instruction to decode and run. Two stacks for passing and working with values. 64 kilobytes of main memory. That's pretty much where you put everything, your program and all your data. And then device ports for reading and writing, interacting with the actual emulator, like drawing, playing sounds. And that's really it. That's all you have to care about. There's nothing else. So if you want to know what a Uxn program does, just focus on these things. When Varvara starts up, it reads the ROM into main memory, starting at address 256. It sets the program counter to that address and runs until it receives a break instruction. This phase is often called reset, since it will happen every time the VM starts up or resets. Once the reset vector finishes, the VM will run other code in response to other events. So for example, the console vector runs when text is on standard input, screen vector runs up to 60 times a second, audio runs when a sound finishes playing, and the mouse and controller run on their respective inputs as well. So that's it. Again, each vector is just a sequence of assembly instructions that eventually ends in a break. So you might wonder why I became so invested in Uxn when there are other interesting fantasy consoles out there, such as Pico 8, TIC 80, Pixel, and many, many more. In fact, some of these are even more constrained than Varvara is in certain ways. So Pico 8's 128 by 108, 28 pixel display is smaller than Varvara often uses. I don't want to criticize other fantasy consoles. In fact, I think they're all pretty interesting. Which fantasy console you might use comes down to the constraints you find interesting or valuable and what other goals you have. In my case, I value Uxn's radical simplicity. So Uxn TALL, the language you tend to work with, is much simpler than Lua, JavaScript, or Python. So I'm not only confident that I know how to use the language, but also how to implement it myself. I can't really say the same thing about JavaScript or Python without a lot of work. Similarly, while there are independent implementations of many popular fantasy console emulators, the effort there seems much larger than Varvara and sometimes involves reverse engineering. I love creating games that people can play in a web browser, on computers, or on handheld devices they've already got. So for example, here's my talk running on my 3DS. So you can see going through the slides here. Maybe if I had more courage, I would have actually done the talk this way, but I'm not quite that courageous. But it's possible that I'll eventually find some of Varvara's constraints limiting. In that case, I'm confident I'll be able to create a new VM, port my ROMs over, and continue. In fact, Devin has explicitly said they hope that Uxn inspires more people to create their own convivial computing systems. Regardless, the goal of my talk isn't to convince you, the roguelike celebration attendee, to drop everything and start using Uxn only. Instead, my goal is to help encourage you or help you consider whether a smaller, simpler, and cozier computing environment would be adequate or even beneficial for your game development practice and for the world. Thank you. So here's some more information and links. I don't think I'll have time for questions, but I'm happy to talk with you afterwards.
Excellent. Thank you. I think that's a great call to action, especially for a roguelike crowd that is already, you know, pretty excited and comfortable working these kind of constraints. It was making me think, I recently bought a bunch of Zachtronics games, and partly because some of them were like, hey, it's like you're programming assembly. And I'm totally. Like, yeah, I miss programming in assembly. When there were like 10 things that I could do, and that was the entire space of things I could do. And it's like, there is a longing for the simplicity of that type of puzzling. And it's interesting to me that like, that's compelling enough to be a game that people want to have artificial constraints that make them program things in a very limited feature set. And, you know, you could be doing it.
Yeah, I love those games. Maybe I'm just drawn to this stuff, you know?
Yeah. Well, and I think, I mean, enough people are that is a beloved little niche of games. So yeah, I think that's great. And I love that you have it running on a 3DS. That's beautiful. Maybe we should get someone to help us run the mud so that you could join Roguelike Celebration.
From 3DS. I would love to help you do that. Yeah.
Excellent. Well, fantastic. Yes, hopefully people will be able to follow up with you afterwards in a WIP show. So thank you very much. Great to have you back.